All right. Sorry, everyone. I seem to have lost the thing that lets us advance the slides. I'm just going to do it manually from the laptop over here. So I do computer graphics, and I want to tell you a bit about what the future holds in store for computer graphics. But before I do that, I want to give you a bit of a sense of what computer graphics actually is. So maybe you guys remember this movie, Toy Story. It came out in the mid-1990s, and it was revolutionary. Because it was the first full-length feature film that was actually 100% computer graphics. Nothing in here was filmed. It was all special effects. And the technology back then was rather primitive. If you look very closely at the skin of the characters, you can see it's very glossy, very plasticky, very flat. It doesn't look like real skin. And if you look at the legs of Woody there, you can see there's some kind of candy wrapper crinkling going on there. But that was all okay, right? These were supposed to be toys. They were supposed to be stylized. It didn't matter that it didn't look super realistic. Of course, nowadays, you go and you watch a AAA action movie, and the effects are just amazing. This is Force Awakens, came out earlier this year. And I can go watch this movie, and I know how these special effects are made. I know what the tricks are, and I know the things to look for. Even still, I have a really hard time telling which things here are fake, which are actual film, and which are computer graphic special effects. Now, of course, all of this is an illusion, right? If you want to show a planet blowing up in a movie, you can't just create a virtual planet and blow it up at scale. Even a Hollywood budget does not let you do this. For any kind of virtual world, if you peel back the curtain, no matter how detailed, no matter how nuanced a virtual world actually looks like, the data structures that are used to represent it are surprisingly coarse. And this is the fundamental problem of computer graphics. We want to be able to show, we want to be able to act on smooth objects in the real world with lots of detail and very complex behavior. But we have these limitations that are imposed on us. We have a finite amount of memory that we're allowed to use, a finite amount of computation that we're allowed to do on this data. And we have to come up with how to represent the geometry, represent the behavior in a smart way, so that we can build these discrete surrogates of real objects in a way that you can't tell the difference between what's real and what's virtual. Now, one area where we've really been able to succeed very well at this is in rendering. Rendering is the process of taking a virtual world and making a picture out of it, or making a movie out of it. There's this joke going around in computer graphics that rendering is a solved problem. And this is a joke. It's meant to antagonize the colleagues that work on rendering as their research. But like every joke, there's a kernel of truth to it. One of the grand triumphs of computer graphics over the past 50 years is that we can now do this. We can now take the virtual world and render it so well that you can't tell that it's real or not. There was one really cool thing that happened earlier this year where there's this hoax that's around on the internet that the moon landing was fake. Or there's a conspiracy theory going around that the moon landing was fake. There's claims that, oh, if there's an astronaut that's in the shadow of the moon lander, there's no way he should look so bright in a photograph if he were actually on the moon. It must be a soundstage in Hollywood. It can't be real. And researchers actually, or artists and researchers actually tried this. They looked at the optical properties of moon dust, and they did a rendering of what it would look like if the astronaut were actually on the moon. And lo and behold, the astronaut would actually be as bright as he is in the photograph if he were on the moon. That means we're in on the conspiracy. That's right, that's right, that's right. We're in NASA's pockets. So if rendering is a solved problem, what is it that we're going to be looking forward to in the future? What is next for computer graphics? Now, there's three different areas I want to briefly talk about in terms of the future of graphics. Capturing the 3D world, capturing the geometry around us and creating virtual copies of that. Actually making geometry using technologies like 3D printing. And finally, melding together the virtual and real world using things like augmented reality. So now, we heard this morning from Kristen Grauman about computer vision, how that's really revolutionizing how we can perceive the world around us using computer science with personal cameras and so forth. And I want to push this idea even further. Has anyone here used Microsoft Kinect or another kind of depth sensor before? A couple of people? So the Kinect is a camera, but it's a special kind of camera. It doesn't just see color. It also sees distance. It can see how far away different parts of the image are from the viewer. And this was marketed as a video game controller. The idea is you set this up in your living room, and you start dancing in front of this thing, and it can figure out where your limbs are because it can see the depth. And it uses that to let you control video game characters. It's really kind of an odd marketing idea. I think it was really a tragedy that it was marketed in this way, because controlling video games is kind of a niche area, right? The really revolutionary thing about the Kinect is that it gave everyday people access to 3D data in an unprecedented way. And now this 3D data is not great. This is an actual visualization of the kind of data you would get out of the Kinect. You can see it's very low resolution. It's very noisy. you're only seeing one side of the person, and even then there's lots of shadows and stuff where you don't see any data. And computer graphics people have come up with algorithms that even with this noisy data can apply some rather sophisticated mathematics and computer science to try to reconstruct a solid object from that data. And the results you get kind of look like this. So here you have a messy desk, and the Kinect's been used to try to reconstruct the geometry of this desk, and several views have been stitched together. The different colors you see down there are the different views that kind of combined to make the final thing. And you can see this is not a great reconstruction. You can see that the keyboard looks more like a molten chocolate bar than an actual keyboard. And the person's hand has fused into the table. We know that the hand should be resting on top of the table, but here it's just kind of melted into the table. And it's easy to blame the hardware. It's easy to say, oh, we just need more points, more resolution. But that's not really the problem here. The problem here is that we're not understanding the 3D world. That's why we're getting these results. It's not just that we are missing points. I can give you an even more complex example. I can give you this tower here that's made out of blocks. Someone threw a ball at it, and now it's going to start collapsing. Lots of what's going on here is hidden, right? Lots of this collapsing geometry is hidden, but we have no trouble understanding what's happening here because we know how physics works in the 3D world. We know that these blocks are supposed to be rigid and that there's friction holding them together up until they start to crumble. And once they're crumbling, that they're going to start piling on top of each other and sliding around. And this is what's really missing right now from our algorithms. It's not enough just to look at colors. It's not enough just to look at even distance. We have to understand the interrelationships of objects in the 3D world to be able to make sense of these kinds of scenes. Once we can do that, we can finally start to have the applications that have been promised to us as these technologies have been developed. Teleconferencing, where you actually have a real representation of the person in the conference call. Or even more exciting for me, I like to play video games. I want to actually put my body in the video game. I don't want to play as some avatar of some other person. I want to actually be able to interact with the world myself. I want to be able to walk around. I want to be able to go traveling somewhere and come back and have passively collected a 3D representation of everything I've seen and be able to walk around. If I go visit Rome, I want to be able to come home and then walk around Rome again, reliving my experience from the data I've collected. And this is all the kinds of things that will be possible in the future. Now, the flip side of capturing the 3D world is actually being able to shape it using something like 3D printing. How many of you have used 3D printing before? Have tried to model something or at least download something from the internet and send it to a 3D printer to try to make a 3D object? A few people here? Yeah, especially if you're at UT, there's makerspaces, like the mechanical engineering department has a place where you can go and actually use a 3D printer and try it out. And it's the kind of technology where, if you remember back a few years ago when the MakerBot first hit the shelves, and there was a lot of hype around the MakerBot, people were saying things like, oh, you're going to be able to do anything, you're going to be able to print anything you want, musical instruments that actually play, prosthetics that actually work. There was a lot of hype. There was even headlines saying things like, never go to the store again. Anything you would buy in a store, you can just make from home now using a 3D printer. And a few years later, what's the actual status of this? Well, if all you ever want to buy from a store are coasters and Christmas tree ornaments, then mission accomplished. You can do this using a 3D printer from home. We're still far away from actually making functional things. You can go online. You can find data that should be able to make things like this. This little widget here has a spring and some gears. It's supposed to be a winding mechanism that you might put inside of a pocket watch. And people have tried to print this out and use it, and you can see all kinds of user complaints about this thing. It doesn't work. It's not working. I tried it several times. The motor won't rotate. Every time, it either jams or breaks. Just one touch makes it break. And what's going on here? Again, it's really tempting to blame the technology. We don't have enough resolution in our printers. We need to print at the micron level instead of the millimeter level. But this is really not really what's going on. The problem is that we don't have the software, the algorithms, for really pushing the hardware to its full potential. One example of this is that in order to make 3D printed objects, we're still using software tools from the 1980s that were used to design ship hulls and car hoods, right? If you want to specify a solid object that you want to print, you specify the outer skin of the object using these old CAD tools. And this really doesn't make any sense because what happens inside an object actually matters. You want to have control over this, right? If you want an object that's light but very strong, you want to control the inside. You want to hollow it out. You want to put a honeycomb structure in there like you would have with bones. Or if you want to make an object that's squishy, you want to make some parts of the object very spongy, have lots of gaps inside, so it's more deformable than other parts that you want to be harder. Of course, deformation is one thing you want to control, but we can go much farther than that, right? We want to be able to specify how an object should sound if you blow on it, what an object should feel like if you touch it, what kind of color an object should have. And we don't even have a language for how to specify that right now. We don't even have a way of writing data structure that encodes this thing, never mind actual software that lets us do this. One thing that I'm really hoping is going to happen in the next 10, 20 years is that we'll actually have a Photoshop that lets us do this, lets us as ordinary users say, I want to make an ocarina, and here's kind of what it should look like, and here's kind of what it should sound like. Figure out how to 3D print it so it actually does this. Now, if modeling the outside skin of an object is not the right way to represent 3D printed geometry, what is? Well, one thing I've been really excited about recently is looking at how shapes form in nature due to growth. So here's a bunch of different leaf shapes, for example. And looking at these, you might think that the space of possible leaf shapes is very rich. There's lots of different kinds of leaves you can have. And because like a maple leaf looks nothing like a poplar leaf, but that's really an illusion. Nature's playing a trick on us. The shapes look very different, but all of these were formed in the same way. There was a disk of material that started off as a bud, and it grew. And the only difference between a maple leaf and a poplar leaf is how it grew, which parts grew faster than other parts. And that can be specified just using a very small amount of information. Even something super complex, like the kale leaf over there on the right, this is something that's impossible to 3D print right now because of all the wrinkles and folding of that geometry. But it's absolutely trivial to manufacture if you just take a disk of flat material and just tell it grow uniformly everywhere. Mathematically, you're guaranteed to eventually end up with something like this. Now, of course, we're not limited to leaves, right? There's lots of cases in nature. We have very complicated things that grow from just a few simple rules. I guess kind of the crown jewel of this is the human body, right? The human genome is 700 megabytes big. That's less data than is required to show a TV show, not even an HD TV show, right? Or low resolution TV show. And somehow that information is enough to encode the complicated structure. And can we somehow tap into this to come up with better representations of the geometry we want to create? People have already started to look at this. So you can try to do manufacturing using these ideas, and you can get shapes that start to look like the kale leaf by using growth to shape what you're doing. And you can also start looking at deformations. You can look at how flowers open up or close due to the stretching of the material. And I guess I have an unexpected demo over here, right, where you can look at these leaves. And you can see that due to the drying of the leaves, you have that some of the leaves have started wilting and changing shape because of that. Is there a way that we can control this and use this in our printing to make deforming objects? All right. So the last thing I want to touch on is virtual reality. I can't give a talk about the future of computer graphics without talking about virtual reality. And this is supposed to be kind of an awkward spot because I'm a virtual reality skeptic. I'm not so convinced that virtual reality is going to be as instrumental in our future as some people think. First of all, virtual reality is not even that new of an idea. It came about much older than you might expect. Even in the 1960s, Ivan Sutherland, who is the father of computer graphics, was playing around with head-mounted displays. Back then, the hardware was so heavy, you had to mount it from the ceiling. And you had this very imposing rig you had to mount from the ceiling. It was called the Sword of Damocles, because I guess the users were a bit worried about what might happen if that thing came loose. And the graphics it could show were very primitive. It could show line drawings of things like molecules, cyclohexane you could see in 3D. Or you could walk around a very simple wire sculpture version of a room. And the Oculus now has a better form factor and much better graphics that you can show. But the limitation is still there. Up until the day when we just plug ourselves into the matrix and never leave our apartments again, we're not going to want to wander around the street wearing a headset that completely blocks out the outside world. There's no point in doing that. What I think is going to be much more important to our future than virtual reality is augmented reality, combining both the real world and the artificial world. This is something everyday people might actually want to be able to do. I want to be able to play basketball and have the computer analyze my shots and say, hey, you're doing this all wrong. You should be shooting this way instead. It's going to improve your game much better. I want the computer to be able to see me building things out of Legos and give me advice about the architecture of my buildings. I want to be able to ask what-if questions, like what if I try to do this thing out of Legos? Is it going to stand up or not? And the computer can tell me, oh, yeah, it's going to work fine. Or, oh, no, this thing is going to collapse. And getting augmented reality to be really useful in this way is going to require solving some of the problems I've already talked about, how to capture the virtual world and so forth. I want to end with just a couple of other problems that are maybe a bit more subtle that we'll have to solve in order to really get augmented reality to be as effective as we want. One of the applications of augmented reality I've seen is sculpting things in the virtual world, having some shape that you can basically sculpt like you would clay. And this is the kind of thing that sounds great in principle, is not so good in actual practice, because so much of our experience with creating things ourselves has to do with our tactile experience with 3D shape. If you strap on a pair of augmented reality goggles and try to sculpt things out of smoke, right, sculpt things out of ghostly material, you just can't do it as well as you can real materials because you don't have the feedback there. People are starting to work at this or making gloves that you can wear that are supposed to give you force feedback, or you have controllers now you can move around in space. Those are only partial solutions. I think the thing we really want is we want some kind of smart clay that we can sculpt in the real world, but that knows its shape. It can infer its shape as it's being sculpted and upload that to the computer, and then have the computer process that in virtual reality. So for example, I could sculpt a person out of this smart clay and then have that start to animate and see it in augmented reality. And the last thing is that we have proprioception. I can close my eyes and just kind of move my body around. And even though I'm not directly sensing where my limbs are, I know where they are because I have experience with my body. I know how my body moves. And this is something that augmented reality is having a big trouble with right now, is being able to track what the user is doing with their body, especially the hand, because the hand is so complex. And if you move your hand, you're hiding parts of the hand, then it's appearing again. One thing that I'd love to be able to do, which no hardware can do right now, is grab a pen in the real world and start to write and have that writing show up in augmented reality. This right now is totally impossible because the software cannot track accurately enough the fine motions of the hand and the motions of the props in a way that it can predict what's actually being written. And this is something that's going to have to be tackled to really make augmented reality useful. Okay, so I hope I've given you a taste of the kinds of things that we're thinking about in computer graphics in terms of the future. And I mentioned earlier that one of the triumphs of the past 50 years of computer graphics was doing rendering right, to the point where we can show a picture of the moon and a person on the moon, and you can't tell if it's real or fake. What I'm hoping will happen is that in 50 years, when UTCS has its 100th anniversary symposium, someone's going to come down here on the stage and say that the triumph of the next 50 years of computer graphics was making it so you can't just see a picture of the moon, but you can actually experience for yourself what it's like to be on the moon and interact with objects as if they were on the moon and not be able to tell that it's actually virtual reality and not the actual reality. Thank you very much.
that one in there, but okay, so let's get going.